Thanks for the invitation. I'll try to honor it. I didn't manage to send you my presentation title, so your introduction is not correct. I'm giving a presentation on another of your topics, so soft market, which I found more challenging, soft market and strategies, how reinsurers can deal with the situation. And I'm very excited because I will present the research work done by Professor Paula Szczerzakowski at City University of London, whom I met last year in one of the talks. And they have carried in many years research on strategy on reinsurance. So I found the framework they developed very useful, and especially in the context of the soft cycle, and precisely in this reinsurance market where the trends have conspired to squeeze the reinsurance margins. So the question is there a cycle anymore? Is this a new reality? And how we should deal with it? So I'll try to be quick. So I have 1.5 minutes per slide, but I'll touch the main points, and you can ask any questions later. Thank you. So I will take you back to 2009, because that was the year I entered reinsurance, and I will take you back to Monte Carlo in September 2009, and some of you will remember that reinsurers were optimistic, the financial crisis more or less left them unaffected. There were some discussions of investors wanting to pump capital into the market, but overall executives thought there are other opportunities in the financial markets, so they didn't really see that as a threat. So, you know, basically you had a very stable market where the price would depend largely on the nat cat activity of the year. So, surprise, surprise, 2010, and then you have many changes. So starting 2010, you have serious nat cat events, and the problem is that the usual way reinsurance was working, so you have accumulation of nat cat events, capitals are affected, you expect a payback through an increased premium rate, and that didn't happen. Okay, so instead of that, we saw a huge consolidation of the reinsurance buyers, so cedants consolidate. We saw ILS exploding, so cat bonds, etc. And we saw a fierce competition of reinsurance wanting to enter emerging markets, etc. So all the paradigm we knew until 2009, from 2010 onwards, has changed. And I will present the framework how we can understand these changes. So many of you will recognize this. This is the Porter's five force model. So in the original model, you have five forces interacting in a market and determining how much of a potential margin there is in that market. So you have suppliers. In this case, we have suppliers of capital, of models, and human capital. We have the new entrants. We have the rivals, the reinsurers. We have substitutes, and we have buyers. Those are the five forces. But in this case, we have to add the brokers. The reinsurance broker has a very dynamic role. We'll go a bit more into depth of what and why they exist, and they act as complementors. And this creates a situation where sometimes they act as competitors, sometimes they act as substitutes, and sometimes they act as collaborators with the reinsurers. So, if we start from the buyers, so what happened in the meantime? So sedans consolidated into what we can call super sedans. If you take an insurer like AXA, in the last 10 years, they grew by 47%. Okay, so these are sedans that can do many things other sedans couldn't do before. For example, they can bundle risk effectively, so they can spend less on reinsurance. They can walk away from the market when the price is not good enough for them, so they can increase their retention. They have the ability, they have the reserves. This consolidation has created fewer overall players, and that has increased their power in the market. Secondly, substitutes. Before 2009, yes, there were some cat bonds, mainly after Katrina, but there were not real substitutes for reinsurance. After 2010, we have the explosion of the ILS, and we have also another substitute, which is the increased capacity. So increased retention by the supersedents becomes a substitute. If we go to the suppliers of capital, the problem there is that we see a peak in the capital supply and reinsurance. And the problem is not the peak itself, it's the fact that it's no more connected to reinsurance events. It's connected to the kind of returns you can get in other financial markets. So in a low interest environment, you see this peak and it's not connected to the actual cat events that occur. We have the modeling companies that set a benchmark for what is the technical boundaries of pricing the risk, and this has many implications because it has given power to brokers to become substitutes for what services before the reinsurers could provide. It has given power to the cedants. They can bundle into what we call super risks, multi-country, global accumulation of risk that can be analyzed through these models. So reinsurance lose power because of the modeling companies. And of course, we have the human capital that it becomes a lot more expensive because there's a lot of competition for it. The new entrants, we have the hedge funds. They have the investment pool, the investment capital pool, so they can overcome the barrier of the high capital intensity of the industry. So they already have the capital and they have the tax advantage using the reinsurance form. We have insurance companies that become a new entrants. Examples, Allianz Re, VIG Re, so you have these super cedants that now form their own reinsurance companies. And of course the brokers, will talk about them right now. So the forces of rivalry between the reinsurers also increased in the last 4 years because the pie becomes much smaller. And of course we have some cooperative forces, but they're not enough to change this situation. So the brokers, traditionally, one could see them as competitors. So what they did were able to move margin from the reinsurers to the buyers, okay, by giving them more bargaining power. Then brokers move, become more sophisticated, and they provide substitute services for what before only reinsurers could provide, like structuring and analytics. So reinsurers, what do they lose by that? They lose the capability to distinguish themselves from other reinsurers that couldn't do this, couldn't provide these services. Of course, you know, brokers become collaborators, they promote your reinsurance brand in a region that you're not known, they give you access to risks, but you know, in a soft market and because of the competition of brokers between them, at the end of the day, I don't see the collaborator working so well. The This chart shows you how the market forces are squeezing the reinsurance and how their margin has decreased. So let's take the suppliers. So it was the power was medium. Now it's. It's high, and they're driving rates down. The new entrants have divided the reinsurance pie even more thinly. The buyers drove the rates down by bundling and retaining risk. The rivalry has intensified over a smaller pie. And last but not least, the regulation has played a very important role. The standardization, having technical standards has forced the buyers to become more technical. And by becoming more technical, they have a better ability to choose between reinsurance in the most cost-effective way, something that they didn't have the ability before. And reinsurance are not so able to differentiate between them. So what the researchers suggest is that there should be a focus on the competitive strategy. There should be a redefinition of the competitive strategy. So they came up with clusters of buyers of reinsurance based on their needs. Okay, so there are three dimensions that you should analyze the buyers. So one is their capital, their capitalization needs. The needs to coordinate, if they're a big group, they need to coordinate between them, and the way they bundle their products, okay? So on the low end of everything, you have the emerging market insurers, where they have low capitalization, and they usually buy bouquets. They bundle everything together. Then we move to the local players, where they have a small need for coordination. They have good capitalization and a medium product bundling, so they have treaties that are standalone. Then you can go to the regional, where the regionals have. As you can see there, they have a need for coordination. They're not so well capitalized, and they have homogeneous large pool of risks. And finally, at the top, you have the global. They have the capital, they have the homogeneous risk, the diversification, and they have a high need for coordination. So based on those definitions of the buyer, we should look at the reinsurance product life cycle. So different reinsurance products are at a different moment of their life cycle. So a product that is in decline and is mostly in, we see it in emerging markets, is the bouquet. Okay, so it's single territory or similar territory and multiple types of risk. The standalone is a product that's been in maturity for a long time, is not growing anymore, is actually decreasing. And the reason it's decreasing is as global players acquire new local companies, these products disappear from the market. And what is really growing are the super risks, which is the what the supersedents are placing. And of course, you have the non-traditional reinsurance transfer the non-traditional, both in reinsurance and non-reinsurance, like cat bonds, and they're becoming substitutes. And all the big players have embraced either as fronter or issuing their own bonds, providing structured insurance, etc. So the goal here is, as a reinsurer, you have to find your feet. Okay, what is the target client? What is the client that needs me? How do I compete in a soft market? I have to target the client that needs me. But in order to do that, I need to understand what is my strategic position. So the researchers came up with these five clusters of reinsurance, and they explain how this is matched to the products and the cedants. So you have at the bottom end, you have the price-taking profiteers. There are examples of these could be Bermudian reinsurers. Their aim is profitability. They focus on cycle management. And three elements of their approach: monoline, analyzable, very analyzable data and business. And they have a transactional approach. They go in, they go out, depending on the price. Then you have the deal-making partners. Those are, they aim at large discrete deals with high ROE. They also have a monoline approach. They require analyzable data. But they have a long perspective. They have a long relationship. So they try to lock in their partner. They try to lock in the buyer. And the biggest example of this is Berkshire Hathaway. This is the deal-making partner par excellence. Then you have a flexible reinsurer that sits down in the middle, which is the patchwork partner. They're flexible, but they also manage the cycle very well. They evaluate on a per-line basis. They require moderate technical business, analyzable business. The continuity, they appreciate continuity of the relationship. And they manage the cycle rather than the portfolio. So they don't optimize the portfolio so much rather than cycle. And then you have the portfolio partners, which are right at the top, so they're high on everything, and you can think of the big four belong in this category: Swiss Re, Munich Re, Score, and Hanover. So they optimize portfolio diversification, and they have the scale and the scope to do so. They try to get preferential terms because they have a whole account approach. They have a technical approach, but they evaluate the risk on a long year basis. So it's not just this year. And strong continuity on the relationship. And finally, you have a species that is under disappearance, which is the blanket partners. They also have a portfolio approach. They try to diversify seriously. Whole account, they like bouquets. The underwriter has knowledge of the seed and the market, but they're not very technical, and they value continuity. But in this environment, where the kind of products they write are disappearing, and the kind of partners they have, they're also disappearing, in my opinion, there are endangered species. So what are the suggestions? What you should do in this soft environment? So first of all, you need to find your strategic fit. You need to do correct matchmaking. I mean, the brokers also need to help on this. So if you are a portfolio partner, what you can basically do everything. You should avoid emerging markets unless you have a local operation, and this is what many of the big four have done. The deal-making partner, the natural fit is the regional, because the regional is big enough, but it doesn't have enough capital. And acceptable fits are the global and the local players. The price-taking profiteers, they have a good fit is the regional. Less of a fit is the global and the local, because of the lack of relationship, and the global because of the technicality of the risk. The patchwork partner has a natural fit, the local player. And that's why many of the reinsurance that belong into this category have found this environment very challenging. They're also good fit with specialty and acceptable fit with regional. Blanket partners are good fit with local and emerging, more with emerging, as I said, and for the previous reasons. And the final suggestion is, all these players, they need to understand their strategic positioning and evaluate whether they need to make a move. And there are good indications that they should move. Many of them have moved. And sometimes within the same organization, you have different reinsurers. Okay, some they go for the global and the highly technical, others go for more less technical risk. So the portfolio partner, for example, could divest from some lines of business, reduce the exposure from lines that are low profitable and concentrate on lines and territories that have the most profit. The deal-making partner can consider line integration also to satisfy ratings for the diversification and generate more opportunities because they have the long-term relationships. The price takers definitely need to move towards more relationships. The patchwork partner needs to emphasize, they need to decide which strategy to use. They're going to go more relationship or more technical. So they definitely they need to move into one of the other groups, and the blanket partner needs to move for sure because it's a very technically driven world. So I don't know the time, I don't know if I took a bit more, but this is the presentation. It's fascinating work they have done, and if anybody wants the link to their work, I'm more than happy to provide. So thank you.
Thank you also very much. Oh, Andrea has a question for you.
Very short question for Sam.
Okay.
Very interesting. I'm happy to see Swiss Re. Where would you see Arch Re?
Yes, I would say Arch Re is started, Arch Re has evolved. So Arch Re started as a price taking profiteer, as many of the 2001 class. So at the beginning they were writing mostly CAT. But now CAT is a very small percentage of the whole book. They moved into a patchwork partner. This is where they are right now. But there are different velocities within the company, so you can manage different clients.